Well, I love economics. I loved economics from the first time I took it in school, college. At MIT, I do empirical economic research, collecting data and analyzing relationships between variables that people care about, like their earnings and their education and what sort of schools they go to and what sort of health care they get and how healthy they are and how much their kids learn. And I get to deploy a set of very powerful tools. We call these econometric tools, tools for causal inference. I deploy those tools to answer questions people care about, like whether it matters if they go to a more selective college, whether it matters if they get screened for cancer, does that actually make them live longer, whether it matters how much education they get, do they earn more as a result, do people who get subsidized college loans, student loans, really benefit from that? Those are the sort of questions I study. Well, Blueprint Labs has expanded a lot since Parag and I started it. It's more than 10 years ago, and now it encompasses a wide range of questions and analyses. Some of it is related to health. That work is led by Nikhil Agarwal, my colleague here at MIT. Some of it's related to the future of work, and that line is led by David Otter, my colleague at MIT, and Duran Acemoglu, another colleague. But Parag and I focus on issues related to schools. A big part of Blueprint's work, from my point of view, is how to measure school qualities. We just released a study this week of different ways of measuring school quality. So a lot of the traditional accountability framework in the United States is based on achievement tests, standardized tests. And the last decade or so has seen some pushback on that. So parents in some areas object to the fact that the school spends a lot of time on that. Many teachers don't like standardized tests. And so the system has responded by introducing new ways of measuring school quality. One of those is surveying the students. And that's become a big part of the accountability regime, with reports to the public on different schools. New York moved to that around 2013 under the then new mayor, and moved away from test scores. So, you know, we're interested in whether that is really a reliable guide to school quality. If your school essentially gets good reviews, is that really a school where kids learn more? As opposed to finding out that a particular school boosts, say, SAT scores. And so what we show is that surveys are not a particularly good way to measure school quality. But in the public school system, the best way to measure school quality, as far as we can tell, is with standardized tests. A good school boosts test scores by teaching more. And what we show in the recent study is that a school that boosts its students' test scores, say MCAS in Boston, or SAT in New York, or Regents in New York, produces better longer-run outcomes, like college attendance and college persistence. And a school that gets good reviews isn't necessarily good in that longer run sense. If you ask me what's the single best predictor of an individual's prospects in life, you know, meaning their earnings, or whether or not they're going to end up poor, or whether their children are going to end up poor, the single best predictor of that is whether they went to college or how much schooling they have. And on average, college graduates and people who spend more time in school have much better economic outcomes.